to join with the Nuno family in celebrating the baptism of their son. Let us raise our voices in our great hymn of praise, the Gloria.
Who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy A reading from the book of Proverbs. A capable wife, who can find her? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. Her children rise up and call her happy. Her husband, too, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her a share in the fruit of her hands, and let her works praise her in the city gates. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. You are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus spoke this parable to his disciples. For it is as if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, and saying, My Lord, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made you 5 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter the joy of your Lord. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, my Lord, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, master, I knew that you are a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter. And I was afraid. So I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours. But his master replied, you wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was mine with interest. So take the talent from him, and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to all who have, more will be given, and they will have in abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, cast him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today's Gospel is one of those passages of Scripture from which a good number of lessons can be taken. All kinds of different tacks that you can take to reflect on from this one passage in the Gospel. But it wasn't until I recently read a reflection on this Gospel that it dawned on me that this Gospel, particularly when it's paired with the psalm that is appointed for this particular Sunday of the liturgical year, speaks absolutely beautifully about fear of the Lord. Now, most of us learned in preparation for confirmation that fear of the Lord is a gift of the Holy Spirit, and some of us may have even learned the definition of the gift. And yet it remains for many people one of those things where when it's mentioned there's this sort of, what do you mean fear of the Lord? Very frequently when we're talking to the grade sevens preparing them for confirmation, they'll say, you know, do you mean I'm supposed to be afraid of God? Well, no, obviously that's not what it means. The great St. Francis de Sales, one of the real masters of the spiritual life, who lived in the late 16th, early 17th century, said that we must fear God from love, not love God from fear. We must fear God from love, not love God from fear. Now, references to fear of God or fear of the Lord occur many times throughout the Scriptures, and it's a phrase easily misunderstood. For the fear that the Scripture speaks of is not something or someone that brings to mind an impulse to flee or to avoid whatever who or whoever causes our fear. Rather, the fear of the Lord that the Scripture speaks of, the fear of the Lord that is a gift of the Holy Spirit, is a reverential awe of God. That beautiful understanding of who God is and who we are in relationship to Him. It's a gift that comes about because of our knowledge of how immensely we are loved by God first, and our desire, therefore, to return that love in kind. It's that reverential awe that leads us to want to do the will of God, because we know who this God is and that he always has our best at heart. It is a fear that is intimately connected with love. Fear of God and love of God are practically two sides of one coin. It's brought out very beautifully in the foundational text in the book of Deuteronomy in the 6th chapter, in which God tells his people 3 times that you shall fear the Lord your God. But then he goes on in that very same chapter with the beautiful phrase that we all know well. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Now, this loving fear of God, the scriptures also intertwine frequently with wisdom and with eternal life. The book of Proverbs says to us that the fear of the Lord is the first stage of wisdom, and it goes on in another chapter to say that the fear of the Lord is the fountain of life. Examples abound, but these few passages are enough to provide a background to explain that this great fear of the Lord, which animates God's people throughout the generations, is something good and positive and holy. There's a reason that today's psalm says, "Blessed are those who fear the Lord." This is why the prophet Isaiah includes fear of the Lord as one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit that the church believes is given to us in the sacrament of confirmation. But this fear is also, almost paradoxically, a very vibrant awareness of who we are in relationship to God. And it's a recognition that there are duties that come from being gifted by God's mercy and his grace. And it is precisely this kind of fear of the Lord that animates the first 2 servants in today's gospel. It's because they know their master and their Lord. It's because they stand in awe of him, because they love him, that they want to do the best with what he entrusts to them. Now, let's not imagine for a moment that even the one who was entrusted with 1 talent was entrusted with little. For most scholars will tell us that a talent is the equivalent of up to 20 years' wages for a skilled laborer. So they were each entrusted with an abundance, just as we all are. The first 2, recognizing their duty to their master, recognizing that their master has entrusted them with this great good to make the most of it that they could, went off and did exactly that. So at the master's return, they were able to say, "This is what we have accomplished with what you have given to us. This is what we want to return to you for your tremendous gifts to us." The third servant, and St. Matthew very much contrasts the one with the other 2, even by the language he uses. Now, the first 2 come to their master and say, "My Lord, You have entrusted me with these great gifts. I have made more, and this is what I return to you." The third comes before him and says, "Master, I hid your gift because I was afraid." A very different kind of fear indeed. The first 2 servants use their talents to produce a profit. The third goes and buries his single talent in the ground, and when asked by his master why, he says that it is out of fear. Out of a fear that stifles. Out of a fear that does not allow one to love. Now, the master's rather damning response is very shocking to modern ears, and we're tempted to think that this master is simply grossly overreacting. But here, what the Lord is doing in this parable is giving us the immensity of the contrast between this holy and righteous fear and a doubtful and faithless fear. The former acts out of love of God and is fearless for the sake of the kingdom. The latter is paralyzed, lacking both faith and love. St. Francis de Sales says to us that we must fear God from love, not love God from fear, because the latter is really no love at all. May God bless you all. Would you please stand? My brothers and sisters, let us invoke the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ on this child about to receive the grace of baptism, on his parents and godparents, and on all the baptized.
Give this child new birth in baptism through the radiant divine mystery of your death and resurrection, and join him to your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer. Make him a faithful disciple and witness to your gospel through baptism and confirmation. Lord, hear our prayer. Lead him through holiness of life to the joys of the heavenly kingdom. Lord, hear our prayer. Make his parents and godparents a shining example of faith to this child. Lord, hear our prayer. Keep his family always in your love. Lord, hear our prayer. Renew the grace of baptism in each of us. Lord, hear our prayer.
And to each of the following invocations, would you please respond, pray for us. Holy Mary, Mother of God,
pray for us.
St. Michael, St. Gabriel, and St. Raphael,
pray for us.
Guardian angel of this child,
pray for us.
Holy angels of God, St. John the Baptist,
pray for us.
St. Samuel,
pray for us.
St. Joseph,
pray for us.
St. Joachim and St. Anne,
pray for us.
St. Peter and St. Paul,
pray for us.
St. Mary Magdalene,
pray for us.
All holy men and women, saints of God,
pray for us.
Almighty ever-living God, who sent your Son into the world to drive out from us the power of Satan, spirit of evil, to bring the human race rescued from darkness into the marvelous kingdom of your light, we humbly beseech you to set this child free of original sin, to make him a temple of your glory, and to grant that your Holy Spirit may always dwell within him, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God, who by his full power accomplished wondrous acts through sacrifice.
Dear parents and godparents, through the sacrament of baptism, the child you have presented is about to receive from the love of God new life by water and the Holy Spirit. For your part, you must strive to bring him up in the practice of the faith, so that the divine life may be preserved from the contagion of sin and may grow in him day by day. If your faith makes you ready to accept this responsibility, then mindful of your own baptism, renounce sin and profess faith in Christ Jesus, the faith of the Church, the faith in which this child is about to be baptized. And I invite all here present to join the parents and godparents in proclaiming and renewing your baptismal promises by responding, "I do," to each of the following questions. My brothers and sisters, do you renounce Satan?
I do.
And all his evil works?
I do.
And all his empty promises?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
This is our faith. This is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess it in Christ Jesus our Lord. The congregation may be seated. Please bring Samuel to the front.
Thank you. Our offertory hymn is number 543, Christ is the World's Light, 543.
Grant to us. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Douglas, our Bishop, Wayne, his auxiliary, and all of them. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of your Lord is now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to one another a sign of Christ's peace.
are hymned communion is in your red celebrated songbook, number 6.1, Bread for the World, 6.1.
Thank you.
Please be seated. First of all, it's a great pleasure to welcome our two newest altar servers, one of whom is probably among our older servers and one of whom is among the youngest, that is Luis and Ryan. Welcome both of you. Once again this year, we will be celebrating a novena of Masses in preparation for our parish feast day, the Solemnity of the Immaculate Conception. Masses will be celebrated at 7:30 in the morning, each day from November 29th to December 7th. This is in addition to, not instead of, our regular parish Masses. And on our feast day, Friday, December 8th, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, His Excellency Bishop Lobsinger will be here to celebrate the Solemn Mass at 7 o'clock in the evening. You are all very welcome. The 2024 Sunday Missals unfortunately did not get put out in time, and so they will be available next weekend and the first Sunday of Advent. The Missals are $5 apiece. Over the next few weekends, we are having a registration drive. In your bulletins this week, or at the back of the church, sometimes some of the ushers have some as well, you'll find registration forms. There are a number of new parishioners we've seen over the last while. If you're new and you haven't registered in the parish yet, please take a form, take the time to register. If you've been around a while and you're already registered, please take a form and re-register anyway, because that's a way we will make sure that we have all of our information updated for current parishioners as well. We have a little bit of an incentive. Your registration form is also your raffle ticket for a draw. And the prize for the draw is a very beautiful nativity set by Fontanini, which can be seen at the back of the church near the South Tower entrance. So over the next 2 weeks, fill out your registration form, bring it back in, put it in the draw. And at the end of the 11 o'clock Mass on the first Sunday of Advent, we'll draw for the Nativity set. If you don't want to go and put it in the drum, just toss it in the collection plate. We'll make sure it gets in the drum for you. There are still tickets for the Cardinal's Dinner, the gala dinner in honor of Cardinal Collins. That will be this Thursday evening at the Italian Canadian Club. I understand that the Knights of Columbus are putting on quite a charcuterie board. So please do come early, enjoy some hors d'oeuvres and cocktails. The schedule for Advent and Christmas will be available in next week's bulletin and will also be posted on the parish website. This week, the lamps at the Regina Caeli Shrine burn in loving memory of Gaetano Cecca and Anna Cecca Spiri. And once again, as always, the parish gift shop is open in the parish hall